The story of a failed integration. These are very heavy words.
But this novel can be read not as a novel about the lives of immigrants and their integration or lack of. It can be read not as a novel about East and Western relations between them. It can be read about identity, and identity in the broader sense, not identity of the immigrants, but the human identity, how people develop their identity, how this identity changed, does it change? Is it, is identity made up? Is this some kind of an imagined narrative that people adhere to? Or is identity something that kind of solid and sticks to you and you can't get rid of? You can also read it as a novel about alienation. Some of those of this imaginary audience could be Egyptian or New Yorker or something else. As far as Arabic literature is concerned, there are stereotypes and there are filters. We're not talking about individual readers, we're talking about the industry and the market. Publishers who want to make money frame and shape the way Arabic literature and the Arabic Arab identity is portrayed in Europe through their choice of what to be, their selection of what to be translated or not. So what you call identified as very Egyptian, I would remove very Egyptian and I would put identified as identical or close to identical to our stereotypes of what Egyptians are. So if I depict Egyptians who look Western in this stereotype, you wouldn't probably be interested because this, you're looking for the, you know, we moved from the Edward Said's old exotic Oriental to, without offense to Alaa al-Aswani, but to the characters Alaa al-Aswani presents as the new Egyptian. And God knows, maybe in 5 years, you will look for the young, semi-homeless guy on Tahrir Square shouting down with Mubarak as the real, very Egyptian. So these choices by the publishers, they do shape how Europe sees the rest of the world, and this part of the world at least. And unfortunately, I have to say this at the same time, on our part, we're doing next to nothing to change this. So what we do is people like me come here and complain about European publishers, but there is no Arab publisher, private or public, who's trying to break those barriers and present and translate different kind of literature.
Bora Josic. Unser Gast und seine Frau Lydia, geboren 1932, ist Bora ein serbischer und kroatischer Romancier und Essayist, der in Zagreb geboren wurde und bis Anfang der 90er Jahre in Belgrad lebte, bis er aufgrund des Protests gegen das Milosevic-Regime das Land verließ. Er hat mehr als 30 Romane, Erzählbände und Essays verfasst und ist einer der letzten Schriftsteller, der seine Sprache Serbokroatisch nennt, die Ausrichtung jedweder nationalen Literatur ablehnend. Trotz der Preise und dem Kultstatus des Buches landete Josic aufgrund der satirischen, karnevalartigen Beschreibung der sozialistischen Gesellschaft auf der schwarzen Liste und konnte jahrelang nicht veröffentlichen.
Die kulturelle und die geistige Situation damals in Jugoslawien war absolut anders als gleichzeitig in Rumänien oder vergleichsweise in Albanien. Das konnte man damals absolut nicht vergleichen. Und dann passierte wieder etwas, was unser jugoslawisches Spezifikum war, nämlich es gab keine offiziellen Verbote, es gab keine offizielle Zensur, nichts. Es wurde auch irgendwie quasi, ist nichts passiert, aber trotzdem eine geheimnisvolle Stimme hat bewirkt, dass diese Vorstellung einfach nicht mehr weiterlief. Die wurde einfach abgesetzt.
All our critics says, this is engaged art. And being political art, that means you are not enough aesthetical. There is no art without the moral. Actually, that's what we spoke yesterday. The whole public space and all working space is possessed and owned from the people who use patriotism to get rich. And this is the case from Macedonia to Croatia to Belgrade. It's a little bit different, but it is practically the same. Actually, the people are out of the party structure. And this is now the position. Now it's not a nationalistic hyperstructure, it's so-called partocracy. The people who are not inside of the structures, they are actually those civilians who were chased during the war. In the war, you are killing people. In the partocracy and the, today, you are buying people. I mean, from Croatia to Montenegro to Macedonia, because now we see that this nationalism is a kitsch. I mean, this is pornography, singing the songs, it's directly voyeurism, and that it comes to the pop culture, to the rock turbo folk culture. And of course, that is what is for the people, and new class is producing their own culture, which are Hammers, Louis Vuitton, Rolex, and Moles.
Yeah,
so we enter from the battlefield battle directly in Macedonia. You have churches and malls. In Serbia, you have churches and self-service. Churches are national, self-service, this is Europe.